This is your day.
Yes, I believe.
Verse number 12.
Can I read with you?
Yeah, of course.
Number 15 and 16, and we're
going to
go
to lunch. Amen.
Exodus what, chapter 20?
20 and 12. I missed the
same. I got stuff in the crock pot at home.
Sweet. Okay, I'm on focus.
Let's get our daily bread.
Focus. There we go.
Exodus chapter number 20, verse number 12, and then Genesis chapter 17. Can I say amen?
Amen.
Honor thy father and thy mother.
Come on.
That thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee.
Yes.
You kids got that?
Come on now. Sorry.
You kids got that?
Yes.
Honor.
Yes.
Honor.
Your father and your mother.
Yes, Lord. It's written.
That you live long on the earth.
Yes.
Yes.
Live a long time, that means you got to obey mommy and daddy.
Amen.
Tell them, tell them.
Listen, do what they tell you to do.
Speak it to us.
It's going to be good for you when you get all grown up, right, Parker?
Receive it.
Huh?
Amen. They receive. In Jesus' blood, they receive.
Honor your father and your mother. You know, I was reading the scripture. I believe it's in Ecclesiastes, about a generation.
Yes.
Said there is a generation that does not honor the father and does not honor the mother.
Mm-hmm.
They don't honor the parents. We are in that generation.
Yes.
More and more young people have no idea what it is to honor. Cussing mama out, cussing daddy out, cussing grandma out, cussing them out. Tell them I'm going to do what I'm going to do. That's a short-lived life. I'm here to tell you. It's a short-lived life.
Real short.
You want to die of a good old age. See what I'm saying?
Yes.
You want to die like Moses did. You want to die like Abraham did. A good old age.
Yes.
You got that, young man? What did I just say? See? Over there playing. Honor. You want to die in a good old age.
Yes.
Like Abraham. Yes. Right?
Okay.
Like Moses. Because they obeyed their parents all their days.
Yes.
Obey them. I am 51 years old and have never talked back to my mother.
Me neither.
And I never raised my voice against my father.
See?
Never looked at him crossway. Never looked at my mom any kind of way. And she was a single mom. She did the best she could with what she knew, with the God-given instinct. And it's not easy being a mom.
Amen.
I don't know what it's like, but just what I have observed,
it's hard, Pastor.
It's not easy.
It is very hard.
Mom takes up a little bit more than dad does. Let me tell you what dads do.
Right.
Do your thing. Man, they have to back up our things when it comes to dealing with your family and the kids.
They
have to bring the bread home. Slap it on the table and go when you need it. Mom's got to deal with everything else.
Yes.
It's not easy when you're a single mom. There are some here today, oh wait, Genesis chapter 17. So we got that, honor your mom, honor your father, honor your mother, honor. Love them, take care of them. going to tell you something right now. You may have a mom that you don't like. You might have issues with your mother. But I'm going to tell you something right now. That's the only mom you're going to get in this life.
Speak it, Pastor.
That's the only one you are going to get in this life. The only one. Genesis chapter number 17, verse number 15. And God said unto Abraham, as for Sarai, thy wife, I shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name.
Yes.
And I will bless her and give thee a son also of her. Yea, I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of people shall be of her. We are the offspring of this woman that God bless.
Yes.
Therefore, we honor our moms. Young men, don't ever talk back to your mother.
Amen.
Don't ever talk back to your mother. If she tells you to do something, you do it, and there's no questions asked.
Yes.
You guys got it? We don't talk back to our moms.
Amen.
We don't talk back to grandma either. Grandmother. Grandmother. She's like the overseer of the mothers. She still has a responsibility.
Yes.
So you don't talk back to grandma either. I wish I would have been able to know my grandma. I really do.
I have my.
I think I would have been a family. There are some that are here today, and you may not have your mother with you anymore.
Yes.
For whatever reason, the Lord knows.
Right.
But David said in Psalm 27, verse number 10. When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take me up. Still have a mom in the Lord. Still have a dad in the Lord. He is the ultimate parent. He is still the ultimate parent. He can love you like you've never been loved. He will hold you and cherish you and take care of you and love on you like you've never been loved on before. So I'm going to just preach to you for just a few minutes on this subject, what a mother is.
Amen.
What a mother is. You can be seated in the presence of the Lord. In Proverbs chapter number 23, verse 25, the Bible says, thy father and thy mother shall be glad, and she that bare thee shall rejoice. Mothers rejoice in their children. They rejoice in the children. And I know that there are some that are young and they have babies and they don't understand what it is to have babies at a very young age. They're not mature enough to understand motherhood because they're still babies, still kids. And there are some that are given up for adoption. But either way, the Lord put the child in a place to be loved by somebody. She shall rejoice in that child. In Proverbs chapter 4, verse number 3, for I was my father's son. Tender, this is Solomon talking about David and his mother Bathsheba. Tender and only beloved in the sight of my mother. There is something about a mother's love that cannot be separated from her children. There's a bond and there's a connection. I've always, for all these years, tried to figure out how that bonding process works. Because you still have dad who's still real close to their kids. Who still love their children the same way that mom does. But for some reason, there is that bond, and it has to be because they actually carry this child.
Right.
This child is actually a part of the mom and not necessarily physically a part of the dad. Although the dad still shares some of the responsibility, but all the love and the compassion and everything, the nurturing of the child, but there's still something about the mom. There's still something about the mother that both men and women are drawn to. My son is a mama's boy. Not in a bad term, but he is a mama's boy. He's close to his mom.
All right.
It's just like that. And if he had three sons, they are my boys.
No. Scoop back. You're not going to mess with nothing.
Proverbs is a very good book to teach parents how to parent their children. Solomon, in verse number 1, in chapter number 1, verse number 8, says, "My son, hear the instruction of thy father, forsake not the law of thy mother." It is because the mother has the greater responsibility. Dad lays down the instructions, but mom lays down the law. Dad goes off to work, and mom has the responsibility as they are babies to read to that child the Word of God. I think every woman that has been pregnant in this church, I have said, please, while you're pregnant with your child, read the Word out loud. There is something significant that happens to the child when you read the Word out loud to your baby. It might seem to you to be kind of silly to read something that is so grown and mature to an infant child. But the Lord told us to do this in Deuteronomy chapter number 6. He said, "Teach your children my words and my law." And it is the mom's responsibility to do this to the child, to read, that they know the Word of God, because the child can understand and know what the Word of God is while you are reading to them while they are in your belly. When they come out of your belly, they can understand. I don't know how it is. And I don't get it, but if the Lord said to do it, then it is a responsibility on every parent to read the Word of God to their child, that they grow up understanding. This is why there's so much dissension between children and parents in this day and age, because there's no parent that is raising their children on the Word of God. And then they grow up and become 10, 12, 13, 14 years old, and they're already out in the street like grown folks, cussing their mothers out, telling them what they're going to do. No obedience. They wonder why. It's because when they were babies, there was no Word of God in the house. And the Word of God is what sustains and keeps, no matter what happens in that life of that child, no matter how they grow up. And the responsibility falls on mom to do it. It's a great job that mothers have. I commend every mother in this building for all the hard work that you have done to raise your kids the best way that you can. A mother is a source of inspiration, hard work, patience, humility, kindness, simplicity, perseverance, tolerance, forgiveness, understanding, gentleness, confidence, survival, and balance. This is what a mom does. This is what she is the resource of. They have a positive attitude. They exhibit creativity. They have an ability to inspire. They have a sense of loyalty. They have all the patience. They take responsibility. They have determination. They're trustworthy. They correct with love. They're understanding. They care the most. They love the hardest. And they instruct. This is what a mother is. This is why it is a tough job to be a mom. It's not easy. So I commend you, because I know that I have seen all of this in my own life, and I have seen that in you. The nation of Israel produced great mothers. Mothers that their characteristics that I just read. Mothers like Moses' mother, who disobeyed a death threat and put Moses on the water to protect his life.
Yeah.
It was a nation that produced a woman like Naomi. After the death of her two sons, took her daughter-in-law, Ruth, as her own loved daughter, and looked after her until she was married.
Yeah.
It was a nation that produced a mother that knew that she was going to die in a famine and a drought, and said, I'm going to make this last meal for me and my son. It was a nation that produced a woman who begged God for a child, and when the child was grown to be 12 and he died out in the field, said, there's no way that death can come to my child, and ran after the man of God, because she had that perseverance inside of her. She said, there's no way that death can come to my child. I got to figure out an answer. I got to figure out a way. Let me run him down. Let me track him down. You can't take my son away. Perseverance, love, and care. It was a nation that produced a mother that fights for her own children as the tax collector comes to take them away. She's standing at her door and she's fighting tooth and nail. No, you can't have my kids, but by the law I can. And she fights and she fights and she fights until the man of God says, here's the way out. Find you some vessels. But she fought, because that's that survival instinct in a mother to keep her children. She was had determination. She had the love and the care for her kids and said, no way, you're going to have to kill me before you take my kids. She was going to fight all the way to the end. That is a mother. Samson's mother, a praying woman, prays for her son as his eyeballs are plucked out of his head. Prays to God and says, Lord, strengthen me just this once. And he wrapped his arms around the pillars of a heathen temple. And the Bible says that he killed more men that day than all the princes of the Philistines than all his days of his life. But it was also the nation that produced the greatest mother of all. And that was Mary, the mother of Jesus. In John chapter 19 and verse 23, the Bible says, then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts, to every soldier a part, and also his coat. Now the coat was without seam, woven from the top and throughout. They said therefore among themselves, let us not rend it, but cast lots for it. Whose shall it be? That the scripture might be fulfilled, would say, if they parted my raiment among them, and for my vesture they did cast lots. These things therefore the soldiers did. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother, and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleophas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciples standing by, whom he loved, he saith unto his mother, woman, behold thy son. And I look at Mary and I say, you know what? This was a woman that went with her son all the way to the cross. She fought all the way to the cross.
Yes.
Something was getting ready to He's going with you. He's going with you. And she stood and she fought and she persevered. And with everything and every ounce of her, she did it.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
That's the strength of a mother.
Yes, Lord.
The strength of a mom, no matter what the child is going through, is going to stand and fight and say, no way, devil, you can't have my kids.
Yes, don't connect.
And I'm going to end with this. Proverbs 31. An excellent woman, one. Starting at verse 10.
Yes.
I'm reading out of the Amplified Bible. An excellent woman, one who is spiritual. I wish I had a witness in a house. An excellent woman, one who is spiritual.
Yes.
One who is capable.
Yes.
One who is intelligent and virtuous.
Yes.
Who is he who can find her? Encourages and does him only good and not evil all the days of her life. She looks for wool and flax and works with willing hands in delight. She is like the merchant ships abounding with treasures. She brings her household's food from far away. She rises also while it is still night and gives food to her household. In other words, she gets up and she cooks for her family. And assigns tasks to her mates. She considers a field before she buys or accepts it, expanding her business prudently. Sound like somebody I know. With her profits, and she plants fruitful vines in her vineyard. She equips herself with strength, spiritual, mental, and physical fitness for her God-given task.
Yes.
Let me read that again. She equips herself with strength. She equips herself. She puts it on. Not only does she put on her garments, but she's got to get up in the spirit.
Yes.
In the spirit. Jesus. Get up in the spirit.
Yes. Yes.
She can't afford to let her candle go out. She can't afford to let her candle go out.
Yeah.
like my little grandson, little Josh, little babies. And I gotta make sure that her mama is praying and make sure that she's burning the midnight oil. Because she needs to be prepared for what lies ahead. She stretches out her hands to the distaff. And her hands hold the spindle as she spins the wool into thread for clothing. She clothes her kids. She clothes them. You know what I'm talking about?
The word of God.
How do you clothe your kids?
With the word.
You clothe, you clean your kids with the garment of praise. When you praise, when you worship in your own house, and you're teaching your kids to do the same, they are putting on the garment of praise. That's what a mother is. She opens and extends her hand to the poor. And she reaches out her filled hands to the needy. She does not fear the snow for her household, for in all her household are clothed in expensive scarlet wool. She makes for herself coverlets, cushions, and rugs of tapestry. Her clothing is linen, pure and fine and purple wool. Her husband is known in the city's gates. When he sits among the elders of the land, she makes fine linen garments and sells them and supplies sausage to the merchants. Strength and dignity are her clothing. Strength and dignity are her clothing.
That's right.
Come on, mamas. Strength. Strength and dignity should be your clothing.
That's right.
You've got to be strong. And her position is strong.
Ooh.
And secure. You can't be moved.
Yeah.
Mom, you understand what I'm saying to you?
Yeah.
You can't waver in your faith.
Right.
You can't waver in your walk. You can't waver in what you believe. Waver in it, because the moment you start to waver, you put your family in jeopardy. You put your kids in jeopardy. You open up the door to the devil. You open it right up to Satan's world.
Yes, yes, yes.
Believe me what I'm telling you. Believe me what I'm telling you. The world is cold.
Very
hard. It doesn't love. It doesn't like. It doesn't have compassion. It doesn't have mercy. No grace. It's hard. And it's out to destroy. And it's out to destroy your kids. So you've got to have strength and dignity. And your position has to be strong and secure. And she smiles in the future, knowing that she and her family are prepared. Do you know where your future lies? Do you have a goal in mind? Are your children a part of that goal? Are they a part of your vision? If you're going to get there, are your kids going to get there with you? She opens her mouth in skillful and godly wisdom. You understand what I'm saying, moms? When you open your mouth, skillfully and godly should be coming out of it.
Yes.
And the teaching of kindness is on her tongue, giving counsel and instruction. See what I'm saying?
Yes.
Moms,
yes.
You've got to read this to yourself.
Yes.
Over and over and over and over. And over, and it's got to get into your spirit. When it starts, when you read it over and over and over, it starts to become who you are. It starts to become a part of you. This is why I said in the beginning, when you read to your kids the Word of God, they're going to get it. They're going to get it. And they might end up being smarter than you. But they're all grown up.
That's fine.
That's what I'm talking about.
That's right.
Smarter than me.
Yes,
you can
have it.
Doing it right.
Yes.
Hanging in there. When it gets tough. We need our children to know where to go.
Yes.
When it gets tough for them.
Yes.
When they are out of your sight.
Come on.
They need to know where to go.
Yes.
Where is the answer? In the Word of God. They need to know that that sword is their life. She looks well to how things